have Mr. Nupur Prakash Singh with us today. He's a human rights defender, poet, author, a feminist, and a practitioner in participatory decision making. He's currently a consultant in the Urban Knowledge Activist Hub of Action Aid India. So it's a great honor to have you with us today.
Thank you.
I have a few questions for you with respect to this conference that we are having.
Sure.
So my first question is,
I will eat.
Yeah, sure.
Okay. So my first question is, although right to housing is not a fundamental right given in the Constitution of India, but it has been incorporated under Article 21 by now and then by the Supreme Court, as right to shelter is there in the Francis Corrales case, and there are several other cases. So do you think that the government of India has taken steps to implement these decisions of the Supreme Court?
To be very frank, I would say that, if we take in the Government of India's own data about, 25 million housing shortage,
yes,
of which 99% of the shortage is for economically weaker sections and allied sections, so 99% shortage is for them, it only goes to prove that, the Government of India did nothing so far as the Supreme Court orders are concerned. It didn't bother to consider the various verdicts, fantastic verdicts of the Supreme Court, ensuring, asking for housing rights for the urban poor. And so we are in a mess because various schemes came up, the National Housing Habitat Policy of 98. Then we had the JNNR coming in, and now the PMAY as such.
Yes.
So I would say that it's worked on default mode.
Yeah. So my next question was with respect to PMAY. So do you, as you said, it's not that effectively implemented. What changes would you suggest to it, and what effective measures would you suggest for its implementation?
Yeah, see, I think the first thing which the government needs to do is, we have a very great policy in Delhi at the moment, which talks about, having, institute upgradation as the main policy, and relocation, which will be done seldom.
Okay.
If in case there's no land available nearby, so the relocation will be done. So I think, we need to have a policy which first, and then the policy of Delhi government mentioned Supreme Court orders, High Court orders, saying that housing is a fundamental right and how it should be taken care of. So a policy of the government which mentioned Supreme Court orders, I think surely is wanting to do good for the urban poor, for the city makers that we talk about. So I would say that one is that the government should give up this tag of treating them as personal grata, taking them as encroachers,
yes,
or as illegal people.
Yeah.
So I think one is the settlements which have come up, has come up because of the government's own commission or commission. Both ways. They've not done it.
Yeah.
Or they've taken money and allowed it.
Yes.
Both ways. So two is, we need to have a mission mode kind of way of going about it, because Housing for All 2022, and the government by 2015 had constructed 710 houses. So if you go by that speed, it will take some
million years,
37,000 years,
yeah,
for Housing for All. So that's, I think, it's playing with people's emotions and realities.
Then we have a very prominent problem of slums in India. Mumbai is like the slum state of India. How do you suggest we resolve this problem? What do we do about it? Because even when these people are given proper flats to live in or houses to live in, they just put them on rent or they just sell them, and then they come back to these slums and they stay there.
See, I think the problem is we do not just include them when we decide on some of these issues. Okay, it has to be participatory consultation. So when it suppose like, you know, whether it's Dharavi, wherever it is, you know, Bombay, Delhi, Chennai, whatever, Kolkata and all, I think you always take them as transgressors of public morality, of public law, public ethics and everything, and you only, you know, see them as outlaws. And so the your thing is like, you know, just remove them. So when you remove them by force, you are removing them 20-40 kilometers away from where they were staying earlier.
Right.
So one thing which we have seen clearly is that nobody is in the city for homes or houses.
Yes.
They are in the city for work, for livelihoods. In fact, that's why again, as I mentioned, that we call them city makers. They have made the city with certain labor, they have very right to the city.
Right.
So we have process now which you see is that, you know, you demolish the slums, push them like in Delhi, in Bhavana, Kolimbikala,
in the outskirts of,
absolutely, Sardar Gera, which is 40-50 kilometers away from
there. There's no employment there.
Absolutely. So then what you're doing is you're forcing people to be homeless. They would come and sleep on footpaths of Delhi for about a variable for about 5 days of a week, and weekends they go back home.
Right.
This is a no democratic country. So I think there's a flaw in the policy, flaw in the implementation as such.
So, do you think that the international community can help us in solving this problem that we have in our country, or has it helped us in any way in resolving these problems?
See, you know, I think international community, yes, why not, you know. Surely when you raise these issues internationally, it changes the government. And they are very touchy about these things, you know, about India's pride, India's glory and asmita and all that. So, when international community comes and supports some of these issues, you know, I think that buttresses our work that we do with the informal sector workers and I remember when one shelter was demolished in Delhi for the homeless, the UN Special Report statement, Kuthari's statement, way back in 2004, shamed the government, and Pakistani media carried the news that in India the homeless shelter was demolished, and the government took it very seriously and got a shelter immediately.
So basically naming and shaming.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
It works. But again, I think, see, also like, you know, I want to bring in there that I see also a lot of problems even internationally as well. Like recently I was in Chicago for a meeting. There is not a single public toilet for the homeless there in Chicago. Not a single public toilet for homeless in Chicago. Okay, and this is 2017. So I think, you know, so there are lots of human rights violations, housing, shelters and all in India and across the world. So I think we need to take up these issues nationally and internationally, either place.
So you have been part of the women's movement since 1982. So what do you think that, what steps should be taken for reducing the dependency of women on men for housing and right to land and right to property? Even today, women are very much dependent on men for shelter, for housing. So that means for even those who are not working, how can they be less dependent on men for housing?
See, I think, you know, one is that, like, you know, we have a patriarchal stranglehold. Right? And women, I think, you know, my own practices of socialization that they've undergone, they have been really, you know, to be subdued to men as such. So it's like the empowerment that's happening through social action that we are doing, I think, is also, you know, empowering them. And the thing also about, you know, the pocket titles in the name of women, as you know, like in my own case, like the house that we stay in belongs to my wife, not to me. I told her very clearly that, you know, let it be in your name. I don't want a job membership also. It should be in your name, you know. I don't want that. So I think some of us should also give up, you know.
Yeah.
So I think, because ultimately, like, you know, if we also need to show it to the world, you know, that I think, you know, men, they don't need to have titles in the name. They can allow the women to have it because it's important for them, you know.
Yeah.
And men need to also know that they've been thrown out of the house if they misbehave. If they are drunken and they misbehave and all. And I've been telling women's movement.
It keeps a check on them.
Yes, like I've been telling, you know, the women, you know, when they talk about white patriot and all in various places. I said, you, in the panchayats also, you should throw this man out of the village.
Mm-hmm.
You know, how can they go and bash women like that, you know? So there has to be women's solidarity groups and all coming together, supporting each other, you know. So I would say, I think it's all possible if we have a
we have the guts
to it, you know. Yeah. And women in the country at the moment are well poised to do that.
Yeah, but in the rural stage, what happens is that they're scared of having the man outside their eyes, the house. So even if he's a drunkard, they would bear with him just for the sake of the society that, okay, a man is in the house. That's what the society thinks. So that's a very good, big problem, I think, for the men who are poverty stricken.
But I think things are changing now.
Yeah, they are. Comparatively, they are.
You know, in the places where I think groups are working, I think we are, you know, it is in the world, it's like that kind of thing, you know, that kind of thing. It's Zindabad, you know, that's where they are live and kicking. And we need to have women taking charge of situation and realities. And say no to discrimination, no to patriarchy, no violence. And it's, I think, you know, it will take time, but I think now the time has come, you know.
Eventually things will change. We hope so. Thank you so much, sir. That was my answer. Thank you, Stephen, sir.